riffs are too repetitive, the lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides and the cover art's a mess. There's so much here to tear apart. Listen to it for a week, now that we pass past. Why I hate this album podcast with Tim and Garrett.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Why I Hate This Album. I am one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey. With me, as always, Rosencrantz to my Guildenstern, co-host extraordinaire, Timothy Richardson. Tim, how you doing, buddy?
Well, Garrett, I can tell you how I'm not doing. I am not aroused. I saw the album
art. Glad to hear it.
Saw the album art, saw the song titles. I just assumed this would be a very arousing week, and it isn't.
Oh, okay. You know what? I'll meet you halfway. Sure, it's not nearly as arousing as the cover of this album would have you think, but it's got its moments of temerity.
Disagree.
Is that the word I want?
Disagree. Oh, also, and this is going to crush you. I waited until this very moment to tell you. Disney has once again rejected our Star Wars sequel remake because... And this is true. They lack both vision and imagination.
I hate to say it, but I completely agree with what you just said.
Yep.
Iger, call us.
Come at us, mouse.
Do not come at us. Anywho, Tim, after an entire week and yet another rejection from the House of Mouse, what album have you been listening to for an entire week straight?
I have been listening to Shania Twain's The Woman in Me, released February 7th, 1995. What about you, Garrett? What album have you been listening to this week?
Also, Shania Twain's The Woman in Me. I'm gonna go ahead and shit can this segment in real time. I don't think it works. It makes very little sense. It didn't when you brought it up in the pre-show production meeting, and I tried to yes and you. And is it ever going to be different?
I mean, I hope not.
Best to check.
Because otherwise, yeah, it's going to be check. A terrible episode.
Yeah. Luckily, I too have been listening to the same Shania Twain, The Woman in Me, as you, Tim. And after an entire week with Shania, I have to ask, and I am legitimately curious, do you hate this album?
I do, Garrett. I hate this album. Yeah. Yeah. This is boring trash. We'll get there.
Wow.
What about you? You've been listening to this for the better part of your life. Do you hate this album, Garrett?
No.
Oh,
no, I do
you're
not.
Gonna.
Yeah, I doubt it.
No, you're gonna.
I doubt it.
I will make
it
you
is
hate
boring.
This. Yeah,
it is boring.
Sure is.
It's
boring and stupid.
We'll see.
Not arousing.
At least one song is.
After her history and general thoughts, I might actually re-ask if you hate this, because I think I could get you there by the end of general thoughts.
Wow. Okay. I like this game. Tim, I'm curious, prior to this week, what is your history with Shania and more specifically, the woman in her?
None, Garrett. This came out when I was in the House of Saud. It was not popular there. I believe they saw that cover and the raw sexuality on display in those photos. They said no thank you.
After censoring all portions that were outlined by the Ministry of Vice and Virtue, it turned out to be basically Shania Twain's Black album.
Exactly. What about you? Did you hear, I mean, I know you heard this when you were a gross, impressionable little boy. I assume your father played this exclusively riding in that Corvette. It's a weird childhood you had, but tell me about it.
I did. No, luckily my father was not into Shania Twain.
Well,
at least not her music.
Okay. There it is.
Anyway, but my sister sure as fuck was. So, yeah, man, I know this album. Not great. Like, she luckily was, you know, 16 or 17, so she was just playing the hits. But, yeah, I fucking heard more than a couple of these songs a few thousand times. Anyway, so, yeah, I got a bit of a history, but I don't hate it. And, Tim, you've already touched on it. Let's just go ahead and say it. That Shania Twain is one hot dish.
Yeah, I'll co-sign that.
Yeah, she's a pretty lady. That's a pretty lady down there, Richard. Anyway, yeah, she's a smoke show. And I guess, based on your comments, her general raw sexual appeal on the cover of that album led you to believe that you were about to deal with some saucy tracks.
Yeah, no, I thought this was going to be... borderline pornographic.
Wow.
She really encapsulates 1995 womanhood.
That's true.
But she does nothing with it.
Well, don't co-sign that. Anyway, that's your history. That's my history. Before we can talk about the album at hand, it is customary here on the show to understand a little bit about the woman who made it. So Tim, take us on a journey. I challenge you to help me understand who Shania Twain is, how The Woman in Me came to be, and why I, like you, should in fact hate this album.
Well, Garrett, Shania Twain is Eileen Regina Edwards. She was born in Windsor, Ontario, Canada in 1965. Her parents divorced when she was two. She moved with her mother to Timmins, Ontario, where her mom married Jerry Twain, member of the Ojibwe people, which I know you know, but for our less native peoples inclined listeners, are an Anishinaabe people, leading her to be incorrectly labeled as Native American or Native Canadian or, you know, whatever.
What is that called? First Nations peoples?
Yes. She grew up very poor. They often did not have enough food. There was some unspecified domestic violence between her parents. Her mom had frequent depression. Her mom took the kids and moved to a homeless shelter for a long time in Toronto before moving back in with Jerry. From the age of 8 on, she was forced to sing in bars to help pay bills. She said, "My deepest passion was music and it helped. There were moments when I thought, I hate this. I hated going into bars and being with drunks. But I loved the music, so I survived." Now, Garrett, for a country musician, that's an amazing backstory. That's the kind of thing you could really, it could really lead a person to writing amazing songs about that kind of life, about living on the margins of society, desperation, the dark side of humanity, what it takes to truly survive without having a safety net. It is the classic, like, it is
it's the quintessential country music background. People pay top dollar.
Right.
For the life rights to claim this was their background. Shania got it free.
Yes. This is the kind of backstory that ends in alcohol poisoning at 26.
And but three great albums beforehand.
Sure. And all of that makes me think that that story must be bullshit, because not a bit of that potentially interesting insight is in this record. This is boring, generic trash, and we will get there. Now,
trash.
At 13, she got to perform on the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation's Tommy Hunter Show, one of Garrett's favorites growing up. In her combined high school / vocational school, she sang in a band called Longshot, and then she worked at her dad's reforestation business. She said, "I love the feeling of being stranded. I'm not afraid of being in my own environment, being physical, working hard. I was very strong. I walked miles and miles every day and carried heavy loads of trees. You can't shampoo, use soap or deodorant or makeup. Nothing with scent. You have to bathe and rinse your clothes in the lake. It was a very rugged existence." Garrett, why is this album so goddamn boring?
I don't know, because shit, man. All of that's so interesting.
Right?
Not
She's
a single...
very interesting person.
I assumed when you said you were going to make me hate this album with the history that you were going to bore me to death.
Oh,
it's
no.
It's the opposite.
It is the opposite. She's going to bore you
so
to death.
She's so interesting.
Yeah. After graduating high school, she was in a cover band called Flirt and took singing lessons with Ian Garrett, a man whose house she cleaned as payment for said lessons, and also a man I've spent considerable amount of time trying to get him to seduce Garrett Harvey, because I want Garrett Harvey's name to be Garrett Garrett. Neither one likes each other, and Garrett claims that even if he did marry him, he wouldn't take his name.
Also, we're both heterosexual men.
Yes.
Both of us.
But it's still a funny, funny goof.
Insurmountable odds.
Toronto DJ Stan Campbell noticed her quote-unquote talents, as the internet puts it, and put her on an album he was producing. Then Garrett, her parents, got in a car and started driving through Canada and were murdered in a car accident. She had...
Don't say it like that, dude!
Okay, they were killed in a car accident horribly.
That's better.
Eyeballs everywhere. Here's the problem.
Not everywhere.
Here's
only
the problem
four.
With her parents dying so horribly in that car accident. She had a shit ton of younger siblings I neglected to mention until now.
Oh, God.
So she had to move back home to take care of all of them. So she essentially became the mother to all of these siblings. And she didn't have a job or any, you know, skills other than, you know, being able to sing and, as you described, being pretty. Mm-hmm. So she performed at this terrible hotel / timeshare community to earn money. Now, I've done a deep dive into this specific resort, and I'm not going to mention the name. I suspect this was shadier than singing for cash, Garrett. It looks so shady. It looks like the kind of
lovers jacuzzis in the room.
It just looks like the kind of place that if you're a big shot in Toronto, maybe you're a new hire at a fancy law firm in Toronto, or maybe even Montreal, Garrett, and you go on a little ski vacation to this resort, you know, maybe
the room comes with a lot of perks.
Yeah, exactly. And what I'm saying
and
is,
all
Garrett,
the rooms come with jacuzzi, extra towels. What's the last one? Extra towels?
Yes, it does seem like she was doing something a little bit but then singing. To that, Garrett, I have to say, why is this album not better?
Yeah, because she didn't write most of it.
Well, okay, we'll get to that guy. Once all of her siblings were old enough to take care of themselves, it was time for Eileen Regina to shine. She made a demo and was signed to Mercury Nashville, and then she changed her name to Shania. Now, this is allegedly a horribly mispronounced Ojibwa word that means like on her way or she's on her way. I don't really think it does, but despite being 100% Northern European ancestry, she kind of sidled her way into technically being classified as a First Nations peoples person because her stepdad was full-blooded Ojibwe and she became legally registered as being 50% Native American because in Canada, that's how genetics works. And then she just never really said anything about that. She's also claimed in interviews that her mom told her her biological father was part Cree, but he wasn't, and her mom probably never said that.
What's Cree? Isn't that a race in Marvel?
Maybe.
Because I didn't watch this dreadful Secret Wars or Secret Invasion, whatever the fuck it is, but I'm almost certain it's about the Cree invasion.
The Cree are a North American indigenous people. They live primarily in Canada, where they form one of the country's largest First Nations.
I'd like to take this opportunity to apologize for my previous statements, implying that a First Nations group of Canada was in any way an extraterrestrial.
Absolutely. They can shapeshift, though.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes. So she began recording, and she released a self-titled album on Hitler's birthday, 1993, and did some backing vocals.
Why do you know that offhand? That's not in your notes.
And did some backing vocals on some other Mercury Nashville albums. Now, that album didn't do well initially, probably because people in 1993 were less stoked about Hitler than they seem to be today, but it was eventually certified platinum, and it did pretty well in Europe for whatever reason.
Hmm.
Then South African record producer Robert John Lang, aka Mutt, heard the album. He offered to produce and write songs for her in the future. He will be the Colonel Homer to her Lurleen Lumpkin. They had a whirlwind romance over the phone, really just off from afar. They decided to meet at Nashville's fanfare and were married just a few months later. Colonel Mutt would co-write almost every song on the album of the week in The Woman in Me, released in 1995. This album did pretty good. I will tell you exactly how good after we go through it, but just know, pretty good.
You know, Tim, you and I have never really talked about phone sex. I knew a girl in college that proposed we do this, and I mean, I don't know another way to say it. I was a horny little demon in college, and basically was still like, nah, I'm good. I guess what I'm saying here is I've never really understood the appeal. It just seems like more trouble than it's worth.
Sure. But you did carry on a handwritten letter relationship with a young lady in college that you let me read some. They were pornographic.
Absolutely, Tim. There is nothing more titillating, arousing than the perfectly formed sentence or phrase when written upon a lovely parchment, perhaps with a scent. And of course, you've seen my near perfect cursive.
Yeah,
my capital F's will titillate.
I mean, they titillated me, all right. She released Come On Over in 1997. That sold 40 million copies worldwide. It was best-selling album ever for a lady musician. It was the 9th best-selling album overall in the U.S. She won 4 Grammys for it. Colonel Mutt won another 2 Grammys for it. They also had hits in Europe by making all the songs less country and more pop. And then, Garrett, she went on her first concert tour.
Okay, hold on. They took an album, not this album, the album after this,
Yes.
Which one is it?
Yeah, album after.
Okay, they took that and they decountried it?
Yes.
Further?
Further, yes. What we're listening to today was too country for the hits. And it gets worse because she does it again.
You pop this up anymore, they basically released an Ace of Base album over there.
Absolutely.
Wow.
An indie label then released an album recorded in the late 80s before she signed with Mercury on October 21st, 2001, right as the world was ready to move on and heal to the pop rock tunes of Shania Twain's late 80s period. Then she took a break to have a son and also do a different thing we'll get into in a bit. And then she released Up in 2002, followed by a promotion of the album at the Super Bowl halftime show in 2003 when the Oakland Raiders fell to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers in what would later be called the Pirate Bowl. Hard to pick a side.
What would later
Garrett.
Be described as forgettable.
Yes. No Doubt and Sting also performed that year and kind of upstaged her, but Up was released in three formats. There was a country acoustic, there was a pop rock, and then there was a world dance version because she would like to have all the money, and the world gave her all the money. In 2004, literally, she was given all the money. She also performed on a telethon and was sawed in half by a magician to promote that album. Not literally, it was a magic trick, sorry.
Sure.
Garrett was horrified that the story ended right there.
You know I don't do the history. Yeah. I thought I was about to learn Shania was dead.
She released a Greatest Hits album in 2004 featuring the vocal stylings of Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray fame, and she was in I Heart Huckabees.
Yeah, it's really, really hard not to constantly reference that, but I'm trying.
Yeah, she did some one-off songs for Desperate Housewives and duets on other people's albums. In 2005, she was Canadian knighted and made an officer in the Order of Canada, which, and this is true, gives her the ability to kill a single person within the confines of the country of Canada. Now, unfortunately, Garrett, she used that one free murder up immediately. And I say unfortunately, because right after she killed that man, Colonel Mutt fucked her best friend, Marie Ann Thibaud, and so they separated in 2008 and divorced in 2010. Instead of murdering him, as would have been her right as an official OC, she retaliated by marrying Marie Ann's ex-husband, Nestle executive and chocolatier, Frederick Thibaud, in 2011. To that I say, Garrett, how is this album so goddamn boring?
This is
fascinating.
She's married to an Earl of Chocolate.
Yes, and also I'm giving this away a little bit. The whole time in the background, she's just got spirochetes just digging their way through her. Garrett,
she has
so much Lyme disease, it is wreaking havoc on her.
How long?
Years. There's a series of hiatuses. It's ruining her vocal cords, and they're burrowing their way into her brain.
Of course it is.
Yeah.
It's Lyme disease.
They're killing
That'll
her.
Kill
anyway,
you.
She was in a 6-episode miniseries, Why Not, with Shania Twain on the Oprah Network. Then she headlined Caesar's Palace in Vegas for just over 2 years, from 2012 to 2014. She released her 5th studio album Now in 2017. That's 15 years after the last one, and it debuted at number 1 on the US Billboard 200. In 2018, she underwent a laryngoscopy to have Gore-tex implanted in her throat to reduce the workload on her vocal muscles. Again, she explained at this point that a lot of the long hiatuses she had during her career were maybe not so much due to having kids and her husband banging French chocolate ladies, but more so due to Lyme disease. Apparently, the Borrelia burgdorferi, or possibly Borrelia mayoni, spirochetes, they were just burrowing their way corkscrew-like through her body on their way to her brain, stopping by in her vocal cords, which is, and this is true, Garrett, pretty gross.
Yeah, both gross and life-threatening.
Yep. She did a second Las Vegas residency starting in December 2019, but COVID caused a bunch of problems with that. In 2022, Netflix did a documentary, Not Just a Girl, Fuck You, Gwen Stefani, The Shania Twain Story. I did not bother to watch it because I believe it would just be a bunch of pro-Shania propaganda. She released Queen of Me in 2013, her 6th album, and will be or maybe already did the Queen of Me tour, Le Fays.
Good stuff. And a hearty Shia Labby to you. As we wrap up the history, I do think I saw just yesterday that she's going to fire up a new residency in Las Vegas any day now, so...
Here's the thing, if you see a tick bite her, do not let that tick bite you.
Yeah, that's true. Also, don't put Gore-tex in your throat.
Or do. It seems to be working.
Yeah, I guess so. That's a procedure I didn't know was a thing.
Same here. I would have guessed it wasn't Gore-tex, because I have shoes that have Gore-tex
right.
in them.
Yes. I'm picturing if you were to open up that throat, the little Gore-tex tag is there. She's like, Shania, how's your throat? It's definitely better. Thank you so much. But I got a bit of a tickle. Oh, yeah, that's the Gore-tex tab. Legally, we have to have it.
Yeah, they're really strict about their brand identity.
Yeah. Anyway, that takes us to general thoughts, Timmy. And I feel like you don't have any. Let me kick us off then.
Oh, I have so much, but go ahead.
All right. Musically, this is just barely a country album.
Yeah, most of it is soft rock, adult contemporary. There are a couple of songs that fiddle it up, and they've got a little honky-tonk in them. We'll get there. But yeah, I would say over 50% of this would not count by anyone's logic as a country album.
Yeah, even by very weak bro country standards, this is mostly just a lady with an accent singing.
And sometimes not with an accent.
Also true. And I don't really give a shit. I'm not gonna hate an album because of that. I might have reclassified it, but whatever.
The ones that are kind of honky-tonky, though, she irritatingly does this faux live thing where she's yelling at the band, like, play it, boys, play it hard, or whatever.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Yeah, I don't care for that. Some of it's Christian music.
Yeah, that took me weirdly, like, the third listen through, I was like, oh.
Yeah.
This is pretty Jesus-y.
Yeah. Well, she probably had to lean on Jesus a lot to get through that childhood.
Or possibly to get through that spirochete incident.
True.
I'm curious, what are your thoughts on Mutt?
I think it's weird.
He's not bad.
No, he's okay. The problem for me is that the lyrics they chose to write seem to be coming at the end of their relationship, not the beginning. It doesn't really, like, this album doesn't make any sense considering that they just got married.
It's mostly about breakups.
Right. And it's mostly about, like, the most banal breakup you could possibly have. Just, yeah, we grew apart.
Yeah.
You know, nothing major happened. It's just, you know, I'm on the road a lot. He's at home. We just sort of started leading different lives. We just stopped sort of relating as well to each other. And sure, you know, we have the kids, but, you know, we'll still be good parents. We're going to co-parent, but, you know, this is not interesting. This is not a song. Like, here's the problem, Garrett. And this is going to be my push. I want to try and make you hate this right here.
Okay.
Given the history that I read, my expectations are sky high for a Shania Twain album. This should be about alcohol and meth and domestic violence and opiate addiction and the disappearance of Native American women and the authorities not caring about the disappearance of Native American women. It should be about murder and bitterness and revenge and generational blood feuds. It should be about her parents dying, backwoods
hunting
cults.
Down the murderers of her family.
Exactly.
Hunting down all four topazes.
Right. Yes. It should be about how time is a flat circle. It should be about how she had to do horrible things at that resort to pay for her siblings' food. It should be about why she has that Chelsea grin. This should be about a very...
It's small point of clarity that she just has a very big smile.
Fair enough. But she could pass.
She has the most interesting life ever, and she doesn't make a single reference to it.
Right. These songs should be Townes Van Zandt-y and early Chris Knighty and Loretta Lynn-y and various Hank Williams-y. But instead, instead of all of that, Garrett, this is a workplace stock photo of an album.
It's the picture that comes with frames.
Exactly. She somehow came out of her childhood as the kind of person at your boring office job that reminds you that there is in fact a dress code, and that dress code includes pleats on those chinos, and don't let it happen again, mister. It is middle of the road, it is boring, it takes no chances, it says nothing, absolutely nothing about who she is. Every bit of it sounds like filler on a somewhat better but still really mediocre album. It's not fun. Now, granted, she has $400 million as a result of making this, but it still sucks. It sucks, Garrett, and I want you to hate it. I want you to hate it now.
Yeah, but she's very pretty.
She is bad in bed, Garrett.
Yeah, she might
be. She is the sort of person, and we'll get to it, probably the first song, who is extremely bad in bed, but just, she thinks she's good, right? She is convinced she's great.
That's the worst.
And it's just like, yeah, I'm pretty. Of course I know.
Not the same, ladies. Not the same. In fact, sometimes, you know what? I shouldn't say this. Yeah, well, this is just for us. Sometimes the...
We're going to bleep all of that.
Okay, let's stick on topic, Tim. We talked about the general concepts. We've talked about the fact that this is almost a duet of an album between Shania and her husband, or soon-to-be husband at the time, Mutt.
Oh, he was her husband already. Yeah, they got married like 3 months after meeting.
Oh, Jesus. That's always a good sign. Although they did stay together for like a decade till he banged that chick. Also, I didn't want to interrupt, but like, I love that Shania Twain, seller of 40 million albums in a single year, who literally must have more money than she can actually actually know what to do with is like, who understands what it's like to be ludicrously rich? Who makes Hershey's?
Hi, I'm Philip Hershey.
Oh, you'll do.
You'll do.
You get it then. Sure do, friend. Anyway, I didn't want to let that pass because God damn it, her life is interesting.
But here's the
Where
thing.
Is that?
I don't think that that's why she married that guy.
No, it was totally revenge.
Yeah. And that's way more interesting.
It's absolutely insane. It's absolutely insane. Although a very similar thing happened to me, or not me, happened to my parents when we sold our house. So the house that I lived in when I was born was unsellable because it's in a part of Fort Worth that nobody wants to live. But the builder of the home that we moved into had an affair with his wife, I believe, with our cleaning lady. And so he bought our old house, basically traded it, and moved in with the cleaning lady. And we got the house that he had built.
Is this the one I've been to?
Yeah. So, you know, shit happens. It was weird. Just a weird switcheroo. So maybe it was completely consensual, Tim. Maybe it wasn't actually.
I think your dad set this up. Like, he paid off some people. There's...
It's some sort of Saul Goodman-esque ruse to get this guy to cheat on his wife so we can get
exactly
a house for free.
Yeah, he probably hired some sort of mic.
I mean, honestly, it's very, very conceivable because, I mean, this is 1994 and we have a cleaning lady that comes once a month and we didn't have money then. They did eventually, but we didn't then. So I don't know what the fuck they were paying this cleaning lady.
Sex
so
with this cheating. Guy.
That's what I'm saying. So that means she really was on hard times, which either means they were a little extra cash to seduce a guy. Probably looks pretty doable, or side benefit, she gets to bone this dude. God, I wish I could remember his name.
Yeah, you would say it right now.
I would. Anyway, I just remember like moving into his house and he moved into our house, but also with our cleaning lady. I was just like, what?
It would be a far weirder story if you didn't move into that second house and this man and his cleaning and your cleaning lady just moved in with you.
Yeah, that'd be even weirder. That would be an 80s sitcom. I think that this album might explain what actually happened in real life with that weird switcheroo, but we'll get there. Let's
I
make
think
sure
so
we hit
too.
All of
them. Yeah. But it's here's the thing about this album. There's a lot of accidental admissions on this album. She has no idea what's going on. She has none. And she's just singing about, and we'll get to it, but she is singing about her marriage in a way, and she is just like, wow, Colonel Mutt, how'd you come up with these lyrics?
Don't worry about it.
You're bad in bed, Shania.
I don't like fucking you anymore, and I'm fucking somebody else. And you haven't figured it out yet.
Garrett Harvey, those aren't good lyrics. In the conversation.
Oh, weird. Weird friendship. All right. Is there anything else we need to say before we get into the song by song?
No, let's move on.
All right. Track number one, Load It Up, Gino. Home ain't where his heart is anymore.
Point number one, far too many parentheticals on this album. Just, yo. She just really abuses it.
Absolutely.
Point two, musically, there's not synth on here.
No, there's no synth on here.
But this song really starts off sounding synthy. It's bizarre. Like,
I believe it to be pedal steel.
Yeah, it is. It's the country instruments, but for 10 seconds, they play them and you're just like, is this synth? What is this?
Yeah, there's some really odd instrumentation across this album. That being the most prevalent.
Yeah.
It doesn't end here.
Yeah, the pedal steel and the fiddle that make several appearances on here make sense for the genre, but they do not make sense for this album or for her.
Yeah, possibly even for the decade.
Yeah, fair.
All right, so this is the seventh single from the album. Seventh, which goes to show you how you sell 40 million albums.
Yeah.
But here's the thing.
Also, all of those singles have 3 million copies sold a piece in C Dingles.
God damn.
Yeah.
The C Dingle. What a ripoff.
Yeah.
Or what a deal if you didn't want to get the whole album.
Fair enough. Lyrically, Garrett, this starts off really sexy.
Mm-hmm.
He knew how to reach me deep inside. He found a part of me I could not hide. And we'd walk and talk and touch tenderly. Then he'd lay me down and make love to me after dark.
I wish I hadn't let you read that. It was all very upsetting. But yeah, off the bat, I am excited sexually.
Yeah.
She has been sexually awakened by this man who gets in there real deep. How deep, Tim?
Very deep.
Deep enough to
out? No, God. Gonna have to bleep that. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, even I find it gross in this point. But in any event, yeah, he gets in there and I think that he sexually awakens her and she discovers either a kink or a lifestyle she didn't previously realize she was into.
Disagree. I think... I think at first they were really into it because it was new. I think the problem is that, well, we'll get into it. But I think the problem is she does not share his adventurous spirit, if you will.
Oh, see, okay. Because I was getting the vibe that they were sort of a polyamorous couple, which actually, you know what? That jives because every polyamorous couple I've ever met, one of them's super into it and the other one smiles awkwardly.
Yes. Yeah.
Song continues. We built a love so strong it couldn't break. There was not a road we were afraid to take. A sexual road.
Do you know a lot of polyamorous couples?
Not that stay together.
Fair enough.
And we'd kiss all the way from Arkansas to Rome, because in each other's arms, we were home, sweet home. Fucking across the world.
Yep, absolutely.
Not afraid to do some weird stuff.
It's a weird two cities they, or two places they choose to mention, but sure.
Yeah, makes me think I'm either not thinking of the correct Arkansas or possibly the correct Rome.
Yeah, it could be like Rome, Georgia or something.
Rome, Arkansas?
Much funnier. And then, Garrett, there's a turn. But he don't feel the same since our lives became years of bills, babies, and chains. Fun point here, hadn't been really years of any of that.
No.
Oh, home ain't where his heart is anymore. He may hang his hat behind our bedroom door, but he don't lay his head down to love me like before. Home ain't where his heart is anymore. Now, as far as I can tell, she does not understand why this relationship is failing. She says bills and babies and chains, but from what I know about her and from some of the other lyrics on this album, my theory is that she is incredibly bad in bed. She's not adventurous. She's not accommodating. She's not willing to experiment. Again, she's the sort of people that thinks that her very presence is enough that she doesn't have to try. But again, convinced that she's really great at it, but she doesn't let him do any of the weird things he's into. There's no chain play, no cat play. She won't even discuss the possibility.
Cat play?
Yeah, like a little...
See, previous episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm with you there because maybe the relationship was new and exciting and she was like, oh yeah, I'm super adventurous and into that. And, you know, after a while, they're, you know, in a long-term relationship and he's like, hey, tonight you want to do the thing? And she's like, no.
Here's the other possibility though. Maybe she's super into it, right? He suggested, you know, you want to do this thing. Well, not just that. What if, okay, she's willing to try all sorts of things, but think Judy Gemstone.
No.
She's doing it. Like, so he's like, you want to do this? And she's like, yeah. And then she describes what she's going to do. And just like, oh, I get that you're trying to be sexy, but I'm just, you know what? Maybe we'll just go to sleep tonight. I don't want that.
Yeah. Like he suggests role play and she suggests like an IRS audit scenario. And he's just like, I don't really want to have sex with a calculator. This isn't, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
So basically no matter what he throws at her, she does it wrong.
Yeah, she's into it, but he's just like,
sure,
no.
Too into it.
Listen, there's a Marianne that I know.
Yes, to quote Danny DeVito, yeah, but not that. Yeah, I think that's great. And that leads me to my final question on this song, Tim. Do you get the impression that he's starting to hang his hat somewhere else?
Yeah, I do.
Because I think if your man's not coming home to, how does she put it, to lay his head down to love me like before, if that's not happening, he's laying his head down somewhere to love somebody.
Maybe. I mean, he might just be tired. You know, he's writing all those songs.
Yeah, sometimes you just got a long, stressful day, but not for weeks on end.
True.
That's a red flag. Track number two. Any man of mine.
We start off a little faster here. Some fiddle, some whooping, some hollering, some weird laughing. And it's admittedly kind of catchy.
It's a pretty fun song. All the songs on a 12-track album, I have the least issue with this song.
Sure. But this is about how she's a nightmare to date, is proudly hypocritical. And generally has that kind of like, if you can't handle me at my worst, you don't deserve me at my best complex. The problem being her worst is not like, oh man, my hair's a little messy today, or or, oh, I was, you know, I'm a little tired, or, you know, I'm grumpy, you know. It's terrible, Garrett. It is. Again, Judy Gemstoney, she's saying all sorts of just creepy things. She's insisting you're into it. Maybe she's punching you.
Oh, God.
It's not good. It's not good.
Let's get into it. Any man of mine better be proud of me. Even when I'm ugly, he still better love me. And I can be late for a date, that's fine. But he better be on time. Now, what she's saying, on the surface, I don't necessarily agree with. He needs to worship her and be willing to wait for her, but he needs to be on time for her. Initially, Tim, big problem. But I got thinking about it, and sadly, after careful consideration, I have to agree with this sentiment in general. Personally, for me, despite being a well-documented, above-average, handsome man, I am cantankerous. I am hairy.
I am confusingly sharp at parts.
Please don't help. I am confusingly sharp at parts. So I kind of have to be grateful and willing to wait if any pretty lady is willing to spend time with me, let alone Shania.
Oh, absolutely. But it's still a shitty attitude for her to take.
She shouldn't rub it in. That's true.
Yes, but here's the thing. So far, listen, this is fine. It's semi-reasonable. I can get past that.
And it's catchy.
Yep. Any man of mine says it fits just right when last year's dress is just a little too tight. And anything I do or say better be okay when I have a bad hair day. Here's where I have a problem. Anything I do or say better be okay. Listen, I was having a bad hair day, and you criticized me. So I burned our daughter's arm with a cigarette. I am a goddamn princess. Anything I do or say fucking better be okay.
All right, I'm going to see how close I can get to your limit that you'd still tolerate. And keep in mind, this is a 1994 Shania. Hates, man. She bought an ant farm.
Super in.
Put it in your bed.
Uh-huh.
And broke it.
Is this the sex thing?
Yeah, she's not good at it. But are you staying with her?
I mean, I assume we're
they're
rich.
They're not fire ants.
I assume we're
ants.
Rich. No, I can't sleep in that bed, but I assume we're rich, sure. So there's probably other rooms. Yeah.
Okay, so you're already making excuses.
Listen, we're going to set that room on fire like it's your bathroom and move on with our lives.
Fire does not fix everything. Okay, how about this? Well, you don't really drink coffee, but let's pretend you did. You wake up, you want a fresh hot cup of coffee. Shania says, hey, I just made some great Folgers. She hands you the mug. You take a sip. It's hot vinegar. It's a joke.
Funny goof. That's a funny goof. Like if she's doing it in a joking way, I think I'm okay.
Okay, let's stay in this vein for just a moment. I'm going to make one small change. It's not hot vinegar, Tim. It's hot piss. As a goof.
Yeah, it's a funny goof, but I'm pissed. It's funny.
You're not leaving her.
I mean, probably not.
Nice.
Nice.
We are making some real progress today. I want to know the breaking point. Let's see. Refuses to flush the toilet.
Out. That's gross.
Right?
Yeah.
That's just gross. You drank her piss earlier, but if she leaves it in the toilet, I'm done. That's weird, but I have the same reaction.
Yeah.
Okay, actually, let's narrow it down, because we're really in a rich vein here. Refuses to flush the toilet, but it's only number ones.
I mean,
I think I'm still out. That's suspicious.
Yeah.
What are you saving it for?
I feel like what I do in that situation is, while she's on tour, I replace all the toilets with an auto flush. Yeah.
Mm, yeah. I think that's what they call compromise. Nice. All right. Good stuff. All right. Song continues. And if I change my mind a million times, I want to hear him say, yeah, 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 yeah. I like it that way.
See, this is weird.
She's abusing the situation.
She is, but also, like, this isn't something anyone should want, right? Like,
right. Nobody wants a yes man.
Yeah, okay. But you're right. It is two things. She seems to be doing exactly what your scenario was. I want to see how far I can push this, because that's fun. And she's abusing the situation. But if she actually means that, that's the worst possible scenario.
Yeah, that's psychotic.
Yeah.
Also, folks, just personally, if you just endlessly change your mind and expect me to be okay with that, I will not be. That shit is annoying. Just pick something, please.
Yeah.
I cannot stand it when people are just like, oh, well, what about this? What about this? Like, if you are in line in front of me and you are ordering fucking food and they make burgers and fries, it should not take more than 2 minutes to order either a single burger or many burgers. Fries? No fries. But yet, every time, Tim, I get in line and the person in front of me is just like, do you guys, well, and explain what these French fries are. And by potatoes, you mean exactly what.
Yeah, so now, I have been in line with you when this has happened, and you just immediately kick them in the back of the knees so that they fold over backward. And then weirdly—
That's why God designed them that way.
Okay, okay. But you then order for them. You make the decisions for them.
You're welcome. You look like you wanted a double cheeseburger and a punch in the face.
They are never thankful.
I think it's the punch in the face.
Yeah.
Okay, song continues. Any man of mine better walk the line, better show me a teasing, squeezing, pleasing kind of time. How do you say this isn't sexy? We're teasing, squeezing, pleasing, Tim. I'm in. Sounds fun, Shania of 1995.
Okay.
I want to tease and please and squeeze.
Right, but she is not flushing that toilet, friend.
Oh,
and
God.
And she wants you to say, yeah, 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 yeah. I like it that way.
Yeah, it's more of a call and response, but I'm with you. Classic tease and squeeze and please and kind of time. God, the toilet thing really
changes
me. Yeah. Who knew? Anyway, song continues. I need a man who knows how the story goes. He's got to be a heart-beating, fine-treating, breathtaking, earthquaking kind of any man of mine. She don't want no scrub. A scrub in this case is a guy who can't get no love from Shania.
Yeah.
Well, any man of mine better disagree when I say another woman's looking better than me. And when I cook him dinner and I burn it black, he better say, I like it like that.
Here's the problem with this whole scenario, because that seems super definite, right? When I cook him dinner and I burn it black, she is going to be consistently testing you throughout your entire relationship until you make love to Marie-Anne.
Who's Marie-Anne? Oh, right. Hershey's princess. I gotta say, Tim, I'm starting to get sort of a weird dominance thing throughout the song.
Yeah.
You put it well. She's testing the limits. She wants to see just how far she can push poor Mutt before he starts fucking the Hershey Queen.
And here's the thing, like, it's gonna get weird because she is equating all of these things to sex, right? So the earth heartbeating, fine treating, earthquaking, whatever. So there's half a chance she's gonna bring out some sort of burnt dinner and be like, tell me you like it. And then you say, yeah, bite. I like it. And then she's like, hey, how about you fuck that dinner? I wanna watch you fuck that dinner and tell me you like it. She's like, okay, this is weird.
I'm not gonna fuck the meatloaf.
This is weird. Yeah, you are. That's the thing.
Yeah, you are.
I'm gonna stop flushing again.
That is the weirdest form of protest, nonviolent protest.
It's so violent.
It's so violent. Folks, I mean, if you want to really, truly institute change in the halls of Congress, stop flushing those toilets.
Hmm.
I don't know exactly how it's going to change things, but I would fucking lose my mind if CNN put a chyron up that says, toilets not flushing, Congress confused. Fucking gross ghoul Nancy Pelosi and Mitch McConnell. I've stopped flushing.
I also have stopped flushing. The American people have spoken. We're not gonna flush.
You people are old mummies. Get out. Do you guys even know what the internet is? Anyway, song wraps up with what I gotta say, an almost song-ruining outro.
Yeah, a lot of them have these. It's
not this bad. This one, she's like, hey, Mutt, wouldn't it be kind of fun if I just like rapped a little on the end? And he was like, whatever, 94, Shania.
And he was like, no, don't do that. And she was like, hey, what is this song about? Right.
I'll stop flushing. She says, you gotta shimmy, shake, make the earthquake, kick, turn, stomp, stomp, then you jump. Wait, heel to toe, do-si-do, till your boots wanna break, till your feet and your back ache. Tim, was she trying to make a dance?
I think so. And here's the thing. Do you think this was written down? Like, is she freestyling this?
No, I think she wrote it down.
See, that's what I think too, and that's worse.
That's worse. That's worse. Because I'll say it again, folks, just in case you're unfamiliar. You gotta shimmy, shake, make the earthquake. Kick, turn, stomp, stomp, then you jump, heel to toe, do-si-do, till your boots want to break, till your feet and your back ache. Keep it moving till you just can't take anymore. Come on, everybody, hit the floor. A 1-2, a 3-4, hup to hup if you want to be a man of mine. That's right, this is what a woman wants. Kind of falls apart at the end. It's bad. It's real bad. And it almost ruins the song for me, but the rest of it's pretty fucking catchy.
It's catchy, but it's, again, it's
offensive.
Yeah, I don't know if it's offensive. But it's
threatening?
I'm a little threatened, yeah.
Yeah. At best, she has a dominance kink and she likes getting off on your suffering. At worst, she's playing nonstop mental mind games in some sort of weird entrapment style way of keeping you in the relationship. I don't know what her end game is. Psychological torture?
Here's the thing. This does not square with her childhood, with her young adulthood, right? This is somebody who she worked reforesting places. She raised all of her siblings. She for their benefit, whoa, allegedly.
Vocally.
And with her.
Oh my God, allegedly. We'll bleep some of that or all of it. Maybe, Tim, maybe this is more indicative of her upbringing than we realize, because we know it wasn't good. We know it was hard. It was tough. There was a lot of general discomfort and unpleasantness throughout her youth. And now maybe she's just broken. She gets off on psychologically manipulating, torturing, and eventually just breaking men.
Mm, okay.
It's just her way of coping, because she has not written about a single fucking thing that happened to her. And it's all so interesting. She's the Trace Atkins of country music.
She really is. She might have been the real shooter of Trace Atkins.
Wouldn't surprise me. She's Canadian. Hardy stock kind of country. Track number three, the one we all know. Whose bed have your boots been under?
Whose bed have your boots been under?
Now, Garrett, as a guy who has participated in numerous affairs, tell me this. Are people placing their boots neatly under the bed while banging? Because I've always assumed in this scenario, it would be a more passionate event. Shoes, clothes, strewn all over.
Oh, see, that's a common misconception, Tim. For anyone... Wait, I'm sorry. Did you say I had numerous affairs?
You've participated in them. I didn't say you had them.
Thank you. Thank you.
People have them with you.
Right. I can't help it. Yeah, I am the proverbial... Oh, go ahead. What are you going to say?
You're a real Marie Anne.
Oh, okay. I thought it was going to be like way meaner. I'll take the Hershey Queen of Philadelphia or the Hershey Queen of Toronto.
She was Hershey Queen of Switzerland, Garrett. She's the real deal. Yeah.
Really? She's
Frederic Thibodeau.
Yeah, of course. I forgot with your incredibly uncanny pronunciation. Before we get into the lyrics themselves, I do want to call out two things. We have not mentioned that the songwriting in this entire album is so formulaically tight. It made writing notes for all of this like insanely simple. It's two verses, a bridge, and a chorus three times with an outro.
Yeah.
Every time.
I kind of thought it made it more difficult, but I know what you mean.
Yes. Yeah. More difficult to have funny jokes, but very easy to parse.
Yeah, absolutely.
Also, it's much faster.
Mm-hmm.
But the other thing I want to point out is if you apply a different harmony or rhythm or whatever the right word is to the lyrics, like most of these songs, and especially this one, has a very 1960s pop vibe, like whose lips have you been kissing?
Oh yeah.
And whose ear did you make a wish in? Very 1960s pop sentiment set to a mildly country theme. But let's get into this one because it's a fucking weird song. It opens with the chorus and she's double tracked for extra emphasis, and it's effective to get the song going. I don't know that I necessarily would have done it. Let's talk about it. Whose bed have your boots been under? Whose bed have your boots been under? And whose heart did you steal, I wonder? This time, did it feel like thunder, baby? But whose bed have your boots been under? Is it just me, or does she seem to be getting off on hearing about this guy cheating on her?
She is, but I also am not sure that this is about cheating. I think this is the first of many songs on this about a woman who believes herself to be in a relationship with somebody she is definitely not in a relationship with.
Oh, I love that. So it wasn't that the relationship was ever firing up or cooling down. It was all in her head.
Yeah, yeah. But she is definitely into, maybe she's calling him on the phone from afar.
Well, I mean, you can bang once in a while and not have a relationship.
No. Garrett, like you, she's super into phone sex, and so she's calling him, but instead of having phone sex, she just wants him to describe what he's doing to people in real life to her on the phone, because she's crazy.
I think
crazy.
That's still phone sex.
Oh, yeah. So what you're into,
It is not what I'm into. I spent the whole first part of the show talking about how much I'm not into it.
Yeah, I know.
I feel like
it's
you didn't understand me at all.
It's one of those protest too much of things. Don't look so lonely. Don't act so blue. I know I'm not the only girl you run to. I know about Lolita, your little Spanish flame. I've seen you around with Rita, the redhead, down the lane. Now, I'm uncomfortable with the mention of Lolita.
Sure.
That's all.
Oh, okay. I think this just furthers the entire narrative that she knows about his dalliances. She may or may not be one of his girls. But most importantly, she seems to be very into talking about and hearing the details around the other ladies he's banging. Maybe it's a little bit of foreplay. I don't know. Certainly not kink shaming, but it's weird if it's true.
Yes.
Like you could, yeah, whatever. And whose lips have you been kissing? And whose ear did you make a wish in? Is she the one that you've been missing, baby? Well, whose bed have your boots been under? Before we get into what she actually said, originally I thought she said, whose well did you make a wish in?
And oh,
I thought that
dear.
Was a very rude way to speak about someone's vagina. Mm. But funny, nonetheless. Unfortunately, that's not what she said. But again, she wants to know who he's been kissing. He wants to know who he's been whispering sweet nothings to. And does he love her? But like, I guess to your point, they're not actually in a relationship. So it's not a red flag to him. He's just like, oh, I have this really good platonic lady friend. Which again, that doesn't really happen. But I guess it kind of does.
What
but
are she you thinks talking they're dating. About? Yes, that's the problem. She believes herself.
I'm trying to figure out why he would entertain her questions. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Oh, yeah, fair enough. I think...
because if they're not dating, he'd be like, you're fucking weird.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think that it's one of those things. She's Shania Twain. She's a lunatic. And he's just like, well, all right, but I'll stick this out, I guess. I don't know.
Doesn't want to upset the apple cart.
Yeah.
I've heard you've been sneaking around with Jill. And what about that weekend with Beverly Hill? Okay, this is tough writing. Also, if you and your girlfriend or supposed girlfriend both know a woman named Beverly Hill, you can't sneak around with her. She'd go find out.
Yeah.
Hell, if you both know a woman named Beverly.
Well, not in 95, though.
Really? Beverly's right in. hatepodmail@gmail.com. Are you in existence?
Yeah, they were much more frequent in 95.
Where did they go?
Giuliani
had him killed like the homeless.
I was going to say.
Gotta get rid of all these Beverlys.
I was going to say they just aged out.
Oh, God. Yikes. Come on, Boots. Oh, yeah. So next time you're lonely, don't call on me. Try the operator. Maybe she's free. So finally, Shania says, you know what? This isn't for me. I'm not going to be just another lady in your state. And then she either calls her Boots like a dog from under his bed, or possibly, Tim, here's a fun twist. What if his name is Boots?
Oh, I love that.
Yeah. It's a fun nickname, by the way.
So, Boots. Well, but in that case, so...
it's about him being under different ladies.
Yeah.
Who's your boot? Who's... it doesn't quite work, but you get my point. Let's see here.
So, okay, hold on. So, maybe which lady have your genitals been under?
Mm-hmm.
Gross.
Why? She's not referring to his genitals as Boots.
Maybe she is, though.
Well, why would she?
I don't know. Maybe he's into that. He's a cowboy after all.
Oh, man. What a funny nickname. What do you call your penis, Boots? It's Tim, and with him as always, Boots. Who's Boots, Tim? I'm glad you asked. Hi, everybody. I'm Boots. Oh, don't take Boots out. Outro implies telling her is required in order to get to stay with her. She says, I want to know who's bed, baby. Whoa, baby. Tell me who's bed. Yes, I want to know. You better start talking or you better start walking. So I guess that's the only way she's getting off.
Yeah, it seems like it. She really does seem to, like, she wants to know. And it doesn't seem to be a deal breaker. You know, she knows all these names. So.
Oh, yeah.
It seems to be something she's into.
I mean, maybe that polyamory from the first song was right on the money. Or maybe it's not really polyamory. It's more just like, just he goes out and bangs ladies and then tells her about it. I don't know. It's weird stuff. Track number 4, where things start to kind of slide. If you're not in it for love, I'm out of here. Girl, yeah, you could be a with a scream. Don't know why.
Yeah. This is... It's a very country take on like an 80s anthem.
Okay.
I don't know. It just has this weird vibe to it.
It is about bad pickup lines, more or less.
Kind
of. Wanting to settle down with a man.
I think... So, sort of. I think this is about how she's just looking for an excuse to bang this guy, right? She's trying to direct him to what to say so that she doesn't feel bad about herself going home with him.
And hey, I am the first one to self-rationalize, so good for you, Shania. But that's an interesting take. Let's get into it a little bit and let's break it down. Song opens. Mind if I sit down? Can I buy you a round? Haven't seen your face before. Are you new in town? It's the same old line. Oh, every time. Are you here alone? Can I take you home?
Okay, for our younger listeners, if you pick up lines, whatever, don't ask, are you here alone? Can I take you home? That makes it sound as if you want to make sure there's no witnesses. And while that's completely obviously going to be the case, you don't want it to sound like that.
Did you tell anyone where you're going this evening and or have an AirTag in your purse? Huh? I mean, can I buy you a drink?
Yeah, that's not what you said.
Right. But so it starts off verse one. We've got essentially just the bad pickup lines.
And Tim, you and I, you know, well, I know you, so I know the answer to this question. Listeners, write in. Like, I don't use pickup lines, and I stopped buying women drinks in college. Are these a thing? Like, I know you have to say something to a woman, but like, never once did it come to my mind to be like, I haven't seen your face before. Okay. I don't know what to do with that. Is that a threat? I guess are you new in town is not so bad. It better be a small fucking town. Like if you're in Los Angeles and you're like, are you new in town? No, I've lived here for 19 years. I just, what are you asking me? There's millions of people here. It's just odd.
I know all of them.
Now every woman sees with every pretty please, there's a pair of lion eyes and a set of keys. He says, come be a star in the back seat of my car. Pause. I got something to say about every fucking line in here. First of all, if your pickup line involves the phrase pretty please, you need to go back to the drawing board. You need to go home, get in the mirror, maybe get one of those dry erase markers and just workshop that for a bit and watch your face when you say pretty please. If that makes you want to fuck something, you need to go to a shrink because you're fucked up. None of us want to fuck somebody saying pretty please. God damn. Next.
I've never seen you this angry.
You have to hate this. I think I hate these people.
Yeah.
I don't know, Tim. Maybe I love it. You know how much I enjoy getting angry. Next line. There's a pair of lying eyes and a set of keys. What are those keys for? I get the lying eyes. Also, again, like, why are all men lying? Jesus. But a set of keys?
I assume it has...
To the car.
Yeah, I assume it has to go to the come be a star in the backseat of my car bit, which...
The way I see it, lying eyes and a set of keys, I'm picturing a steamer trunk, old boy style. Don't go with him. He says, come be a star in the backseat of my car. Is he going to film it?
Possibly.
Or you're just going to be the star of the sex?
I mean, she's definitely going to be that.
Well, sure. She's fucking Shania Twain. Hates chicken salad.
God damn it.
Dude, I'm being on such good behavior.
Yeah, that's fair. But I feel like we're about to really stop having things to talk about. So it's probably going to be more prevalent. Let me make it clear to you, my dear. If you're not in it for love, if you're not willing to give it all you've got, if you're not in it for life, if you're not in it for love, let me make it clear to you, my dear. You're not in it for love. I'm out of here. What she's saying here is stop with these pickup lines. I need you to say something very specific. Memorize this. I will bang you. I promise. You just have to say that you love me so that I don't feel bad about myself. And later when you're not interested, when you don't call, I can pretend you're a bad guy who lied to me and I have no real agency. But I need you to say this.
Listen, you handsome idiot. My friend heard that. I cannot fuck you in good conscience with them having you come in with that bullshit. So just say you're in it for a long-term relationship and we will go home and fuck each other silly. But I can't come at it with, are you new in town? Motherfucker, it's Los Angeles. I'm new in the valley. God, anyway.
Everyone's new to town in Los Angeles. It's...
Fucking go to your shame corner. What is that? Did Gino write that? Gino, no punch up. Jesus.
Oh, no, man. No. He used to have a friend that had that tattooed on him.
That man died.
Yeah. In Los Angeles. 2 days after he got there. Yeah. Not the place for him, apparently. So this is what she wants, right? She's asking for permission.
Yeah. But to fuck this guy.
But verse three, Garrett. Babe, I can change your world, make you a cover girl. You could be a beauty queen in a magazine. Now tell me, what's your sign? Why always the same line? I'll be in number 409 if you change your mind. I think what's happening here is she is asking for permission to use her, let's say it, raw sexuality to get ahead in the entertainment industry while simultaneously pretending that's not what she's doing. Again, it's just tell me you love me so this seems like it's not a business arrangement. I'm going to do it either way, but I'd really feel a lot better if you pretended with me.
Yeah, wow. Shots fired. I love Shania too much to agree with that. I love the interpretation. Can't say you're wrong. I'm going to assume that she's just horned up. She just wants to fuck this mutt and...
Colonel Mutt to you.
Excuse me. She wants to fuck Colonel Mutt and his game is weak as shit. So she's like, hey, you got to do better. better. Okay. If you got the looks, which he doesn't, but whatever. Also, younger listeners, do not give people your room number, because not all people are nice and they might have a friend with really bad ideas. And so they'll come knocking at your door and you'll be like, oh my God, there she is. You open the door, boom, Tim and I there with a blackjack. We rob you blind, steal all your clothes. Don't give people your hotel room number. Always meet in the lobby. Track number 5, the woman in me needs the man in you. This, Tim, is where the album really goes south for me.
Yeah, I officially just hate these songs at this point. This is not good.
Yeah, it slowed way down, sort of sucks. Shania herself said, quote, this was one of, I guess she's aggressively Canadian. This was one of my favorite songs that I've ever written, is The Woman in Me. And that song didn't get the appreciation that I was hoping it would, end quote. I don't know why we haven't been doing the Shania voice. She's aggressively Canadian, reforesting that fucking wilderness.
Yeah.
You know, she must have an incredibly thick Canadian accent.
Just imagine how hairy she must have been showering in that lake.
Why would she be so hairy?
Well, she couldn't like use deodorant or any sort That's of true. Anything. She's, I think,
I don't
she's
know
living
that people go
land.
Feral like hogs do. That seemed to be what you're implying.
Yeah, I mean,
the song. Oh, hey there, how's it going? Oh, hey, Shania. It wasn't until they got her home and shorn that they realized she was a gorgeous woman.
Every Sasquatch has a Shania Twain. You just gotta shave it.
Wow. Doing the heavy lifting this week. This song is sappy piano and pedal steel and a fretless bass that is allegedly easier to press down on, though I gotta imagine it's a lot harder to play on account of there being no frets.
Don't care about any of that. I'm not always strong, and sometimes I'm even wrong. But I win when I choose, and I can't stand to lose. But I can't always be the rock that you see when the nights get too long and I just can't go on. My temper got the best of me, and when I said that, I mean I know every single thing that I said was true, and I know you're mad at me, but if you're thinking like that, I think you'll see that you're mad at you too.
She got into a fight with her hubby.
Yeah, my point being, I would really enjoy seeing this lady argue with Jack White.
Yeah, she's not always strong, but she's classic Shania. She wins when she can, but sometimes even she breaks down. That's not surprising. We all get worn down. Even Shania once in a while might need a break. Song continues, the woman in me needs you to be the man in my arms to hold tenderly, because I'm a woman in love and it's you I run to. Yeah, the woman in me needs the man in you. Now, from her description, Tim, I am picturing her cradling a man in her arms.
Yeah.
And I prefer to think that for whatever reason, maybe it's because of her hurly-burly upbringing, that's how she's comforted, by holding a 200-pound man in her arms.
Or maybe not that. Him. I didn't look up any Colonel Mutt pictures. It's possible that he's a much smaller man than she is. It's possible they have like a Tina Fey and her husband thing going on.
Oh, is he a little man?
He's like 5'4", something like that.
Oh, he's like a little ventriloquist dummy that rides along with her. That's fun. Let's see. I feel like I've hit a nerve, Tim. You're way bigger than 5'4".
I know. I am.
At least 2 inches bigger.
No, come on.
One?
Well, no, I am at least. Yes, that's true. I am at least. God damn it. I am the average height of a man who served in World War II. Not to imply that I served in World War II. I did not.
But that was like 100 years ago. We've all grown since then.
Okay, well, I haven't.
So you were in World War II. You are the Kaiser. Okay, yeah. Let's continue. When the world wants too much and it feels cold and out of touch. Oh, it's a beautiful place when you kiss my face. I just want to say, once again, kissing remains a mystery.
Yeah.
I don't get it. Track number 6, is there life after love?
Angels in heaven and God above.
Garrett, somehow it slows down even further from the past song. Yeah. This sucks too. Hate it.
Yeah, this is where things really, really go south for
me. Yeah, that's what you said on the last song.
Well, they go souther.
Further south.
Some solid acoustic guitar, but that's about the nicest thing I can say. She says, every road has a rainbow and every wish had a star. Every tear had a shoulder to cry on and every night had guitars. I'm not familiar with every road has a rainbow, but I think the message is generally that things used to be really good between her
her and her boo.
Yep.
But every fool's a lonely fool, and such a fool I am. Nope, such a fool am I. Because every night I think of you, and every night I die. So it sounds like they broke up and it was all her fault, because she's a fool.
Yes, because she was just too into the things he was into.
Yeah, she did it too hard.
Is there life after love? Some things aren't certain, but some things I'm sure of, like angels in heaven and God up above. But is there life after love? Is this a Christian album?
Ooh. Maybe. I mean, you got angels in heaven. I don't remember reading about that in geography class. So yeah, I think it's probably at least God adjacent. Or, you know, she could be a closeted Muslim. Well, they have gods and angels in the Quran.
Some things aren't certain. It is uncertain if there is life after love. But some things, Garrett, some things are certain. And the two examples I can think of, angels and God.
Not gravity or oxygen. Angels and God. So allow me to interpret. She asks, is there life after love? Implying that her love has ended. Mm-hmm. And so she is left with the quandary, nay, Tim, the worry that there is no life after love. Her life is meaningless now that she is post-love. But she contrasts this with, some things aren't certain, but some things I'm sure of. The things she's sure of, like angels in heaven and God up above, to your point, are incredibly out of place in this verse, except if the other person in the relationship were, say, dead, then that person got off easy. They don't need to worry about life after love, because she murdered them, sending them to heaven and God up above. She's a killer.
I could see that.
Maybe she fucked him to death with her weird, I love your Judy gemstone. Folks, if you're not watching The Righteous Gemstones, what the fuck are you doing with your life? It's really funny. But in case you're not, that is the perfect encapsulation of a nightmare woman. Somebody who means well, but is so emotionally and psychologically ruined from their upbringing that they can't possibly have a normal human relationship in any capacity.
Yes.
Fantastic. You gave me forgiveness, but you could not forget. No, I should never have told you. That I'll live to regret. The truth lies between us, and I can't take it back. All right, let's pause there. She allegedly was forgiven for her infidelity, but obviously he couldn't forget, and it slowly killed the relationship until she quickly killed him.
Yes.
I also want to point out, Tim, as I have on other episodes, this is all very reminiscent stylistically of the classic Tex Hooper song, Empty Bed.
Jeans and memories. Yeah. I mean, again, and for a good reason, because this album, in a large part, kind of shaped country music into the thing that Norm MacDonald was making fun of some 11 years later.
Yeah, and way better, quite frankly.
Yep.
Now I sleep in an empty bed. Song continues. Here I am, there you are. We're so far apart. Let's pretend that I've never been in his hands, in his heart. Can't we all just start all over again? She is not helping with all that hands and heart talk.
That's true. It's possible, I mean, again, this could be a Colonel Mutt original. Maybe he's written this from her perspective, or maybe he's written this from his own. Right? He is confessing here. This is what he plans on saying to her once she finds out.
I can confirm. This is one of the few, if not only, Shania solos.
Oh, yeah. Gross.
She wrote this whole thing herself.
Huh. Well, she shouldn't have. It's bad.
She's planning on killing Mutt.
Yeah, well, definitely.
Track number 7, If It Don't Take Two.
Here we start off super honky-tonky-ish, honky-tonky-y.
Yeah, that tracks.
Yeah, I think this is about her partner's erectile dysfunction.
Ooh, that's interesting.
Right? Geez, well, let me paint the picture, Garrett. It takes two to tango and two lips to seal a kiss, but a flame and a candle won't burn on a night like this if it don't take two. If it takes two to go one way and two winds be strong enough, but you can't sail on a still day like two ships on a sea of love if it don't take two. He is not getting there, Garrett. The winds are not blowing today. They cannot sail as a couple, but she can get there on her own.
Interesting. See, okay. This is going to be a heated debate, and I'm looking forward for one of us to come to the other side. I'm flexible. Here's my take. In the same ballpark, let's merge these Venn diagrams into a circle. You need two people to climax, is what I got from that. It takes two to tango. Now, I will quibble. It takes two lips to seal a kiss. That's four. It takes four.
That's fair.
Already
your math is way off, half wrong. But okay, but a flame and a candle won't burn on a night like this if it don't take two. See, I got the impression that she can't climax alone. Interesting. Okay, so
well, right. So maybe the problem is she can't get there by herself, and he's just not able to tonight.
Yeah, things are soft and unwilling. They go wet rope.
All right. And then, Garrett, there's a series of Noah's Ark references for no reason. Noah knew what he had to do. Ooh, ooh, oh yeah. He sent us out in the world walking two by two. What?
And that's what made me think it was anti-masturbation.
Because it's secretly a Christian album and God hates masturbation.
Yeah, right. And if you want to be making love, you better be doing so with another person. Or taken even worse, perhaps it's anti-gay marriage or just anti-gay.
I could see that. She seems very conservative.
Yeah, she does. And now we get to the chorus that... God, I'm going to hate myself in the future for doing this. Future Garrett, drop in the chorus right here.
If it don't take two, if it don't take two, if it don't take two.
Okay, the reason I did that is because it's fucking weird. For whatever reason, Robert Mutt Lang, her husband, double tracks himself, and I don't know another way to say it. Is it auto-tuned?
I don't know.
It's so jarring and odd. Well, you all heard it. Hopefully future me put it in there and didn't just edit out this whole part. Lazy fuck. But it's so strange. It goes, if it don't take two, only again doubled and synthed, and I'm not with you. No, it ain't worth going through if it don't take two. Yeah, Charlie. Who's Charlie?
Unclear. I assume it's somebody in her band because she fake yells at the band a bunch after this.
Yeah, I was like, is Charlie Daniels on this song? No.
No. Garrett, no.
Let's see. Song continues. It takes two hearts with one beat, and it takes two to say I do. But the champagne won't taste sweet, and the dream just won't come true if it don't take two. Is it possible, and this is just what my notes say, that this song is anti-marrying yourself?
No, because that would be crazy.
I was in a weird place this week. It's possible, though.
I think what she's saying, so God obviously made everyone in couples, right?
Allegedly.
Just say right so we can move on.
Okay, sure.
Then why will no one stick with her, Garrett?
Noah. Because of that sweet, sweet Switzerland chocolate.
Noah meant for this to be true, Garrett. Noah designed me for you. He designed you for me, and yet you cannot achieve erection.
What's wrong with you, Mutt?
Colonel Mutt.
Let's see.
The problem is you don't address me as Colonel.
The problem is you call my penis boots.
No.
It's hilarious.
I'm into that.
I can't
that.
Laugh and be erect. Untrue.
That is untrue. Track number 8. You win my love. You win my love. You win my love.
Just walk away.
This is an upbeat song about fucking.
Sort of, yeah.
It's also 80% chorus.
This is a song that makes me question if she has had sex. Because it really feels like Steve Carell's Two Big Bags of Sand. It's filled with these incredibly odd descriptions of sexual arousal. The metaphors don't make any sense. They don't...
Yeah.
Let's get into it.
I ended up getting the dictionary out for this song just to make sure that it wasn't me. And to your point, no, it's an effort to extend a metaphor so far that it completely breaks down. It challenges all incredulity.
Yeah, but it breaks down in the second line of verse 1, and then she goes with it for the rest of the song.
Yeah, it's really tough. Let's see it. She begins, I'm looking for a lover who can rev his little engine up.
Let me stop you right there. That's a little emasculating.
Yeah, don't say little engine, ladies. Anyway, he can have a 55 Chevy or a fancy little pickup truck.
Stop saying little.
Also, we are talking about penises, right?
Yes.
Okay, if he's got a cool Cadillac with a jacuzzi in the back,
let me stop you right there. This is what makes me think it's some sort of weird Judy Gemstone thing. Because are the cars...
I'm gonna get in your jacuzzi. My asshole?
Right, because it's around back.
Right, what else would she mean?
This is
what we've been saying. Because this is the perfect example. Oh yeah, what are you gonna do with my roadster? I'm gonna get inside that Cadillac. And then I'm gonna step into the jacuzzi out back, huh?
Right.
Please don't put anything in my jacuzzi.
Yes, there we go.
Oh, God. Anyway, song continues. If he's got a cool Cadillac with a jacuzzi in the back, I'm in. Oh, yeah. Because I'm a classy little chassis who's a-huntin' for a heart to win.
Not classy.
Not classy. She's looking for a lover. She isn't picky about his penis.
Yeah, it can be shaped like any car you want. As long as it's shaped like a car, I do insist on that.
And one of them might have a pool in it. But I actually Googled chassis because I was like, maybe I don't know what she means. Nope, it's a frame for a car. So I guess the joke or metaphor or whatever is that she's looking to get a body on that frame.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Oh, but if you want to win it, there's no speed limit. Just go faster, faster. Don't be slow. Rev it up till your engine blows.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid about premature ejaculation. She likes it fast and hard.
I want it to be over quickly.
Oh, God.
You win my love. You win my soul. You win my heart. Yeah, you get it all. You win my love. You make my motor run. You win my love. Yeah, you're number one. What?
If she likes how you bang, she'll keep you around.
Okay.
Another clumsy verse with a car metaphor that I didn't write down, followed by the bridge. I want a heartbreak Harley, a full of steam dream machine, or just a little late night sexy long stretch limousine. Is this man, penis, or fuck style?
I assume...
When?
I think it's penis.
Could be fuck style.
Limo style? No,
I mean, come
style?
On, long stretch limousine. Yeah.
I think it's penis. I think it's penis, penis with little wheels on the bottom of it that she makes them wear.
Gino, Tim went with the penis with the wheels. Send it to the trophy guy. Okay. Should have that by next week. Track number 9, Raining on Our Love.
The worst are chasing rainbows, blinded by...
Slowing it down again, inexplicably.
This song is a bummer.
Yeah.
It's better than some of the other previous slow songs, but that is by no means an excuse.
Yeah.
She says, remember me, the way I was, the way I'd make you late for work. I had to hold you just because. Remember you, the way you'd wake me to love me once again. We were lovers. We were friends. Pause.
Yeah. They used to bang. They do not bang anymore.
Yeah. Things used to be so great. She would make him late for work by asking to hold him. Once again, Shania is comforted by holding men.
Yes.
Which is fine, but it's just very funny to picture like a man being held in a woman's lap.
Yeah. Here, I do have one bone to pick with you because you read one of these lines incorrectly because there's some whisper singing, sort of, because she doesn't commit to it. She says, I had to hold you just because, like she's going to say, I had to hold you just because fucked me. But she doesn't commit to it. She gets embarrassed halfway through and she quits. So she only whispers the just, and for some reason, only one take.
You know, that's very strange. I picked up on that as well and couldn't articulate it in my notes. And I was just like, you know what? There's no way Tim will notice. I'll move past it. It is weird as fuck.
Yeah.
I don't know why. Just whisper both.
Or don't. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't. Song continues. But was I chasing rainbows, blinded by the sun? And did I take for granted I'd be the only one?
I have been here. So many times, just chasing rainbows until that sun blinds you, and then you're staggering down the highway. Cops pull you over. They think you're drunk.
Yep, but it's just rainbows.
Yep.
It's just rainbows, officer. I didn't know you were so lonely. Am I to blame for making you that way? Did I neglect all that mattered? With my head so far above the clouds, I didn't see that it was raining on our love. Yeah, she got a taste of fame after that first album and started to take this dude for granted, eventually leaving him at home while she's out on tour. He assumes one thing leads to another. You don't date a 1994 Shania Twain and don't think things happen on the road.
Yeah.
They grow apart. The second verse is about how much they used to love each other even more, and that I did not write it down. Before we get to, I was taking all the love you had to give, but I was too lost in life to know that without my love in return, you could not live. Now she gives the love I did not show. This is high school poetry.
Yeah, it really is. And it's gross high school poetry, right? Like, I was taking all the love you had to give. Now, come on. Come on. That is a very, very transparent metaphor, and I do not like it.
Yeah, gross. Track number 10, Leaving is the Only Way Out.
So slow down.
This is an incredibly stupid song, Garrett.
Written entirely by Shania.
Oh, well, there you go. But conceptually, of course leaving is the only way out. That's always true. That's always the case. If the song was dying is the only way out, at least that would mean something. But this is just literally, if you want to leave, you got to leave.
That's absolutely. That's just how leaving works.
Yeah.
Also, I was wrong on that previous song. This is, I think, the only one she wrote completely on her own.
Oh, fair enough. Doesn't really matter.
Not at all.
She's breaking up with someone. She's too proud to cry to trick him into sticking around, I guess.
Yeah, she says, I'm not saying I have all the answers, and I don't care who's right or wrong. I'm trying to pick up the pieces already fallen and put them back where they belong. I think she's trying to salvage the relationship, and he keeps wanting to, like, start up the fight again.
Yeah, okay, so that actually makes more sense, right? So I agree. I think she is trying to salvage the relationship, but she needs him to concede something.
Yeah, just like stop trying to win.
Or just admit that we were both a little wrong. I was the most wrong, but we were both at least a little bit wrong. That's all I need.
Yeah, we both may have said some crazy shit.
Right, and he's just, no.
Nope. Well, I'm glad to hear that you're finally admitting your wrongness, but no, I did nothing wrong.
Right, and listen, if you want to make me admit this, I got a Marie Anne right up the block.
She's Hershey billionaire. Anyway, she continues. So slow down your horses. Stop dragging me around. And if crying is the only way into your heart, then leaving is the only way out. Yeah, see, so she's not interested in starting up the fight again. If the only way that he can be with her is to constantly be fighting with her, she's just gonna leave.
Yeah, okay, and that's fair. If crying is the only way into your heart is a good line, right? Like, if you're saying crying is the only way into your heart, then I'm out. Whatever, that's fine. But when you pair it with and leaving is the only way out, it just makes it stupid.
Yeah, that's fair. Song wraps up with, when late nights and long lies came knocking, you just invited them in. And our voices got too loud for talking. Then my heart hit the floor, but your feet just kept walking. Two things. One, I think our voices got too loud for talking is actually, again, pretty good line. Good job, Shania.
Yeah.
But I do think when late nights and long lies came knocking should have been when late nights and tall tales came knocking. This is a country album, for God's sake.
Sure.
The phrase long lies is not a phrase.
Nope, sure isn't.
Then we get an outro that's basically the chorus, and that brings us to track number 11, the almost final track, No One Needs to Know.
This song was on the soundtrack to Garrett's 5th favorite movie of all time, and also somehow his 7th favorite Bill Paxton movie of all time. I don't really know how the math works out on that. Twister.
This is a super happy, bouncy song. Sounds a little like a country Bare Naked Ladies to me. And there's a harmonica in here, Tim, that I fucking hate.
Yeah, agreed. Agreed. It's also a little upsetting because, again, a country song called No One Needs to Know, knowing her history. This should be like a song about how her friend stumbled upon her hiding her unfaithful husband's corpse. And then her friend assures her, listen, this can be our little secret. Nobody needs to know. Please don't also kill me.
That's a mighty deep grave.
Yeah.
Please don't put me in it.
The other thing, maybe, I mean, this could be more interestingly, this could be a song about how she's slowly going insane. The spirochetes are whispering to her, telling her what to do, and hey, no one needs to know that we're directing you. Anything but what this is.
Well, I do actually think that this is a mildly sinister song.
It feels like While You Were Sleeping.
While You Were Sleeping? The movie?
Yeah. She's got a fantasy life with a man she doesn't know. That's that movie.
God, you know what? This is While You Were Sleeping. That's exactly what I have in my notes. She has a fantasy life with a man she doesn't know.
Yeah.
God damn. I mean, he's not in a coma.
You might be. You don't know that.
God damn it. I took a date on that movie.
Ooh.
I mean, it was like 6th grade or something, but still. We made out. It was pretty cool.
God.
Let's see. Song goes, am I dreaming or stupid? I think I've been hit by Cupid. But no one needs to know right now. That's not good.
No matter what that means, it's not good.
Yeah, exactly. Off the bat, you're just like, ooh, I don't like the sound of that. She continues. I met a tall, dark, and handsome man, and I've been busy making plans. But no one needs to know right now. Can I ask him? I've never understood tall, dark, and handsome. What's the dark part? Dark like me?
I think it's like dark hair, dark eyes, a little mysterious, kind of always standing in the shadows, a little bit of smoke trailing up from that cigar. I have a very specific
type. I'm not Constantine. I wish you hadn't said that. Anyway, song continues. I got my heart set, my feet wet, and he don't even know yet. And no one needs to know right now. All of this is troubling. Why are feet wet? Oh, I don't get your feet wet.
But it comes off as not sexual. That. Yeah.
Or like she peed herself and it's dripping on her feet.
I feel like it comes off as like she's outside of his house and it's raining outside and she's standing in the the mud, peering into a window, which, again, is a feeling that will make you feel like God if you observe someone without their knowing.
I wish you were wrong.
I'm not,
just stop telling people that. It's just how you get more Golden State killers.
I'm just saying, observe. Don't go in there. Don't stack dishes upon one person while you murder another.
It always escalates to that, though. I'll tell him someday, some way, somehow, but I'm going to keep it a secret for now. Oh, God. She is definitely standing in the bushes watching this guy, like, read a book.
Yeah, yeah. She has the wedding planned. She has the children named. I want bells to ring, a choir to sing, the white dress, the guests, the cake, the car, the whole darn thing. But no one needs to know right now. We'll have a little girl, a little boy, a little Benji we call Leroy. But no one needs to know right now. Is this a reference to a 1974 movie about a mutt named Benji? Have you ever seen this? Okay.
Yeah, oh God, yeah, of course. Because of the rhythm of the song, every time I would read the lyrics while I'm listening, I'd be like, we'll have a girl, we'll have a little boy, a little Benji we call Leroy. Like LaCroix? Wait, no, it's gotta be Leroy. Anyway, the bridge goes, and I'm not lonely anymore at night, and he don't know, only he can make it right. Yeah, she's not lonely, because she's watching this dude through the window.
Maybe, but I feel like that would still be, well, I know that's still a somewhat lonely activity, even if you do, again, feel like God while you're doing it. So I think what's happening, I think this is literally a while you were sleeping scenario. I think that she's not lonely anymore because now that he is incapacitated, she's just going in there and laying with him at night.
Oh, could be sort of a hard to kill situation. Have you ever seen that Steven Seagal movie?
I have not.
Oh, it's one of the best ones.
Oh,
we'll watch it after Godzilla tonight.
Ugh.
He gets his whole family's murdered and they believe he's dead too, but he's not. I'm just in a coma. And one of the nurses falls in love with him and like starts checking out his D and giving him sponge baths and it miraculously makes him.
Is it possible that this song is not about...
it might be about Hard to Kill.
Yeah, there you go. It's not about while you were sleeping. It's about the Steven Seagal movie, Hard to Kill.
Yeah, I hope it's Hard to Kill. It doesn't matter. If you've seen it, everyone knows what we're talking about.
What if While You Were Sleeping is just a soft remake of Hard to Kill?
Yeah, it was back in the... it's the inverse of a gritty reboot.
Yeah.
It's a soft reboot. Soft
reboot. A lavender reboot.
There it is. A lavender rethinking.
A velour rethinking. Velvety rethinking.
I think maybe just velvet or velvet rethinking as opposed to a gritty reboot.
Yeah, I like it. Let's make a lot well of done. Let's, you know what? Let's, since Disney screwed us once again on our Star Wars remake, we should maybe write a series of treatments for Steven Seagal movies, maybe for some Liam Neeson movies, some velvet rethinkings.
I like that. Yeah. Or possibly, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. We'll give that Star Wars treatment a velvet rethinking.
Garrett, it was such a good plot, though. It really fixed everything.
It really did. Lost to the ages. Now, I mentioned at the beginning of this song that there's a harmonica throughout it that I hate. Well, this sent me on a bit of a spiral. Turns out there's a harmonica solo in this song that I couldn't get out of my head, so I started doing some research. I call this 80s harmonica or Stevie Wonder harmonica because he plays it on That's What Friends Are For, Isn't She Lovely? I guess that's why they call it the blues, and well over 100 other songs as recently as last year. This is a life bit. It is terrible. It works on those songs I listed because it's Stevie fucking Wonder, but he does it so much that I thought he was on this album. I was like, oh, it's gotta be. There's whole forums dedicated to this guy's harmonica and how bad it is. And it's all through this. It's so bad. It sounds like the animated opening to City Slickers.
Interesting. And it's not Stevie Wonder.
It is not.
Steven Seagal?
I've been known to play some mouth harp once in a while.
He would say Jew's harp. Come on.
Track number 12, Gino. God bless the child.
If ever there was an argument for the rule of 11, this is it. It is an a cappella song. It feels like an even worse Sarah McLachlan commercial. It's just, it's so bad.
In the arms of... That song triggers me now. I'm picturing Sad Labs. How dare they? Hmm. Fucking three-legged dogs and shaking cats. Fucking,
yeah.
Fuck you, McLachlan. She knows what she's doing.
Shania Twain for this.
Yeah, this is pure horse swaggle. I assume, okay, I'm going to read just a tiny bit, just a tiny bit. She says, hallelujah, hallelujah, God bless the child who suffers. Hallelujah, hallelujah, God bless the young without mothers. Hallelujah, hallelujah, etc. All the people that she wants to, you know, have happy fantasy good times in the world. When she says, God bless the child who suffers, is the child Christ? It's Christ, right?
I believe so, yeah.
Okay, this is a Christian album. I might hate this. Yeah. All right. Tim, how did this do?
It did okay, Garrett. This boring piece of shit is certified duo decouple platinum, or as you like to say, mono diamond with an additional double platinum as of December
12
million 2000. Yes. It has sold over 20 million copies worldwide. It is generally credited as having changed the very sound of country music, obviously for the worse. It hit number 5 on the US Billboard 200, number 1 on the US country chart, number 17 in Australia, number 7 in Canada, number 35 in Europe as a whole, number 72 in Germany, 60 in Ireland, 38 in New Zealand, number 5 on the Norwegian VG Lista, number 3 in the Scottish, number 7 in the UK, and of course, number 48 in the Dutch. It was the 38th best-selling album of the US in the 90s, outdone, of course, by her next album, Come On Over, which sold 40 million copies worldwide and was the 3rd best-selling album of the 90s and 158th best-selling album of the aughts, as well as a number 1 in the Dutch. For what it's worth, The Woman and Me received 19 Dutch thumbs up to Come On Over's 18, so the Dutch, currently at least, prefer The Woman and Me. Overall, Shania Twain has sold more than 100 million albums worldwide. Now, this is especially impressive because she has 6 studio albums, and one of those was released like 4 months ago.
Jesus.
For comparison, Bob Dylan has sold more than 145 million albums, but he has released 40 studio albums, the first being 61 years ago, and each of these people has a Nobel Prize.
Wait, no, that's not true.
Hers is for physics.
I do not want to contradict you. I promised you I would do that less on the show, but I am going to put it on the Let's Check It board.
You know, can we bring up the Let's Check It board? Shania Twain, physics, Nobel Prize. I know it sounds wrong, but we're not going to contradict him. No, it's not appeasement. No, he's not going to turn into a... Listen, yes, you are the expert on fascism. We'll do this later.
Sorry, go ahead. What did people think of it?
Well, Garrett, we have a Robert Christgau review, so we can play the Robert Christgau game. The Robert Garrett, as you know, as our audience knows, the Robert Christgau game is where I read a review by noted crazy person Robert Christgau. His review may or may not have anything to do with the album. His grade may or may not have anything to do with his review or the album. And then you're going to try and guess it. You're going to try and get in the mind of a crazy person. And I have a little bonus. I have looked up all of the other albums we know that he graded on this very same day for comparison.
Oh, weird.
Yeah.
Okay.
A country gal from Canada in the great white bread tradition of Anne Murray. Only how times have changed. Murray's voice is forthrightly wholesome, where Twain's is mildly lubricious. She'd never wear bikini-cut jeans or a cowboy hat, makeup, or lake up to her clavicle and your imagination. And of course, she hasn't devoted her career to convincing men that women with character aren't a threat. For all of this, Murray became a lesbian hero. Shania will have none of that. Garrett, that's his weird, weird review. What is
I'm really at a loss this week.
What does Robert Christgau think of this album? And for the record, it is a letter grade.
I don't feel like he really addressed the music.
No, or...
it was mostly about what she would wear and standing in a lake. Okay, B plus.
C. He gave this a C. Now, for a little bit of comparison, that same day, November 28th, 1995, when he reviewed this, he gave a C to Bone Thugs and Harmony E, 1999 Eternal, B minus to Bush 16 Stone, C minus to Korn's self-titled, C plus to Live's Throwing Copper, D plus to Marilyn Manson's Smell Like Children, C plus to Dave Matthews' Under the Table and Dreaming, and a C to Silverchair's Frog Stomp. I think he was having a bad day that day.
Yeah, a bit of a mood for Christgau. Now, I'm not going to lie, I did agree with at least half of those, but
absolutely.
Frog Stomping C, go fuck yourself, Christgau. Fun times. What did the plebs think of it, Timmy?
Well, there are 791 total ratings, 4.8 out of 5 stars on average, 88% 5 star, 2% 1 star. The first, from 2013, is by Pen Name. I originally bought this album in February of 1995, just after my first marriage. For my wife, it was Valentine's Day. I went to the local record store the day it was released, hoping to impress the woman in my life, and hid it in the closet for a whole 7 days. I didn't think there was any other way to say say happy V-Day than to welcome my beautiful new wife home to a nice homemade meal and the frisky sounds of good old Shania. More specifically, honey, I'm home. But boy, did I find out she was singing No One Needs to Know to someone else. As I waited up all night, like a fool, the sounds of Leaving is the Only Way Out played in my new Pioneer speakers, and it clicked that her boots were clearly under someone else's bed. The boots I bought. To sum up, while the timing of this album seemed to bring out the whore in her, it really brought out the woman in me, that I'm a macho guy. I bought this album again for a second and current wife just a few weeks ago, and I'll tell you, it was the answer I had waited for all these years. I recommend this purchase to anyone looking to impress your gal or any funny loving lady or fella. From all the ups and downs Shania has had in her life, she really knows how to uplift anyone out of a depression. Buy this product. You will not regret it. 5 out of 5 stars.
I was really hoping when he bought it for the second wife, it was going to go on to say, and that fucking bitch started cheating on me too. Listen, do not buy this album. It is the ring for relationships. 7 days.
Oh.
Just ends with a bunch of circles. What the fuck? Oh, good review. What else you got?
This is by Dexter from 2016. Shania Twain is not as serious as I expected. There's a lot of things she does that I really wish she didn't do. Plus, she is sexist. It's hard to be a man and enjoy her at the same time. 3 out of 5 stars.
I find most of my enjoyment of Shania Twain stems from the fact that I am a man.
Hmm. Well, not Dexter, because she's sexist. And she does things he wishes she would not do.
Dexter, I don't know you at all, but you might consider that you are a homosexual.
Ryan, in 2022, said, on one of our first dates, we got into an argument, and I frisbee this CD out of the window, never to be seen again. As a form...
That guy's great.
As a form of inner spiritual growth, years later, I repurchased the CD to surprise her, because she always reminded me of that day. Well, the Amazon guy or girl delivered it into the Twilight Zone. We never knew where it was, because the picture that they took was nowhere around our address. I'm still trying to even out the karma of that day of my actions. Shania Twain, holy cow, she is gorgeous still. 1 out of 5 stars.
Wait, why 1
Presumably
out of 5?
Presumably for the delivery, I don't know.
That sucks. Poor Shania. Any others?
Nope.
Great. Tim, who's this for?
I guess Colonel Mutt? For a young, constantly erect Garrett Harvey? I don't know.
Please don't talk about my erectitude. Yeah, I mean, I think it was for everybody.
Yeah, it was for about 20 million people. But Jesus. Not as many as the next one. For that was for 40 million people.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Everybody told a friend. That brings us to final thoughts.
So on essentially 4 albums, she sold 100 million copies.
Yeah, that's incredible.
That's 25 million copies. I did the math per album.
Plus oh, man,
a few
folks, he did.
In 2017. In 2023, but I don't think either one of those sold a million copies, so.
No, 2017 definitely sold a million.
Maybe. I didn't look it up, but I can't imagine.
Who could? Well, 2023 sure as fuck didn't. Anyway, final thoughts, Tim. We've been all the way through it. We definitely did not have nearly as much meat on the bone as we typically do, so for that, we have to knock it. You came in with a hate. I'll be curious to see if you managed to hold on to that flame. Don't answer yet. I don't know. I didn't feel like we didn't have listing, that it was actual music. Nobody screamed at us. These are all things I appreciate in music now. I used to take for granted, but now I don't. I don't know. Anything else you want to impart before we levy the verdict?
I just want to once again remind you of how good this should have been.
God, that's so true. This could have been amazing.
This isn't even a honky-tonk badonkadonk, Garrett.
God, you're right.
I'm going to ask you first this week, Garrett, did I get you there? Do you hate this? Or do you think that this is worthy of her?
Well, you can't tack on extra bullshit. Just gonna ignore that. No.
Oh,
no,
but it sucks, honesty, so bad. Come on.
It sucks hard.
It's so boring. It's terrible. So boring. I could not. I could not listen to this one more time. I might cut my ears off and mail them to prostitutes.
Challenge accepted.
I'm gonna take that back.
Too late. Shred it and burn those ears. Okay, Timmy, we've been all the way through it. Do you hate it?
Yes.
Do you hate it?
I do. I hate this album. This album sucks. She sucks.
But you don't hate it.
I do.
You
hate,
don't
it.
Hate it.
I do.
You don't hate
I
it.
I do hate
is,
it.
Is there life after hate? Not for you. Because you've offended me with your Shania opinion. Okay. You hate it. I don't. That's fine. It's funny. We tend to go back and forth. You have a little bit of a hate streak than I do. And now we're back to you. When will the tables turn? I don't know. But until next week, we'll have have to wait to find out. Folks, if you can, rate, review, subscribe, follow, pledge your firstborn, give us your DNA.
Do not send us your DNA. That's jizz.
You can send us in paper form.
They're going to send it in jizz form, Garrett. You know our listeners.
They might have sent us blood until you started saying jizz a bunch.
Don't send us an envelope filled with blood.
Yeah, probably not. Okay, anyway, you can reach out to us by going to hatepod.com and clicking contact us in the upper left-hand corner, or you can just reach out by going and emailing us at hatepodmail@gmail.com. And boy, we love hearing from you. Every prepisode gets an email from Tim and I each, so you got a pretty good shot of being on the show. And I know we got a huge backlog, but we're slowly chiseling through it, slowly. So please write in with your thoughts, questions, ideas, weird stories. If you relate to any of the things that we said here on the show, maybe you were a big Shania fan. We want to hear about it. So, hatepodmail@gmail.com. Write in. Or you can reach out to us on Instagram. That's hatepod. Twitter's album hatepod. What's the other one? Threads. That's hatepod. And we got subreddits. We got Discord servers. If you want to find us, you know, it's not that fucking hard. Reach out. We would love to hear from you. I think that's about it. For Why I Hate This Album, I have been one of your hosts, Garrett Harvey.
I have been the other, Timothy P. Richardson. And on March 26th, 2015, Garrett P. Harvey said, I still don't quite understand fish.
Yeah, I still don't.
Oh.
8 years later.
Embarrassing.
What are they?
There's cowboys running through my dreams. Nothing's quite the way it seems. I joined the Navy, got kicked out in a week. My facial features aren't distinct. Try to find some meaning in these songs. The genius is a genius, got it wrong. No, it's a lobster murder sex thing. It's the bleaching of the rear. Full assault on both your ears. The riffs are too repetitive. The lyrics make no sense. All the songs are B-sides. The cover art's a mess. Listen to it for a week. Now that week has passed. Why I Hate This Album podcast with Tim and Garrett.